Hi, I'm Richard Feldman. I'm head of technology at NoRed Inc. and I've been using Rust for a number of years, and I understand why it's been voted on stackoverflow.com as the most loved programming language for 5 years running. In this course, we're gonna start out with basic primitives like strings, floats, integers, booleans, and then some collections like tuples, structs, arrays, and how those things interact in memory. Then we'll move on to pattern matching, which is a more advanced concept in Rust. We'll talk about enums, as well as methods and type parameters. Then we'll get to vectors before moving on to some really in-depth Rust-specific concepts, namely ownership, borrowing, and lifetimes. Hope you enjoy the course. So Rust is a language that compiles to either machine code, which would mean like a binary executable, so like a .exe on Windows or just a binary executable on Mac or Linux, or to WebAssembly, which will let you run it in the browser. Who uses Rust? All sorts of people, all sorts of organizations. Mozilla is probably the most well-known because they were sort of bankrolling Rust development for the first like decade or so of its life. They use it in Firefox to power some of their new rendering stuff that's been a lot faster than what they had before. Microsoft has started using Rust in a big way. They are apparently rewriting some of the core like low-level Windows things in Rust. I don't know if that means they're going to rewrite all of Windows in Rust. That seems unlikely. But it is powerful enough that you can use it for really low-level operating system stuff. And Microsoft has joined the Rust Foundation as like one of the most prominent members. Dropbox has been using Rust to improve some of the performance on some of their syncing stuff. There's also sort of lesser-known organizations. Talk, for example, is using Rust to make an embedded systems operating system. Bevy makes a game engine in Rust. Redox is actually a full-blown desktop operating system written entirely in Rust. And you can find more examples of this on the Rust website. So you can see there's a lot of diversity in how Rust is used. It's used by really big companies, really small companies, not, you know, organizations that are not companies, all sorts of different examples. So what can I build with Rust, you might be asking yourself? Well, one of the obvious things for an audience of front-end masters is web servers. Like, you got a front-end, and yeah, usually you need a back-end to go with it. You can absolutely build a web server in Rust. You can also build command line interfaces. This is something that comes up if you're doing tooling, like build tooling, stuff to compile your front end. Also, you can use it to build the front end of a native desktop application. Maybe you don't want to use Electron. You'd rather use something else that's maybe a little bit higher performance. Rust is absolutely something you can use to build native desktop apps. Also, you can just actually use it for web front ends too, via WebAssembly. Now, granted, that's not JavaScript, so if you need to target older browsers, that's not necessarily going to work, but it is something that you can do. A really powerful example of this is makepad.dev. I recommend bringing this up on your phone because it's an example of really like how powerful Rust can be when it comes to making in-browser UIs. Makepad is a fully featured IDE that runs like 60 frames per second on your phone, and it's all built with Rust. So check that out if you want an example of what Rust can do in the browser. Also, you might want to use it for just performance-intensive libraries. That could be in any one of these applications, like web servers, CLIs, native apps, or even in-browser apps, because, again, Rust is really, really good at performance. And finally, like we saw in the previous slide, operating systems. If you really want to build your own operating system, that is, believe it or not, something you can do in Rust. So why would you choose to use Rust? These are some of the things it can do. Why would you choose it over some of the other ways you might build those things? I'm going to give you three reasons: speed, performance, and going real fast. These are really the selling points of Rust. You'll notice a theme here. This is really, like, in my mind, the reason to use Rust over any other like backend technology or any other front-end technology that you might get is Rust unlocks like basically the maximum speed you can possibly get out of your hardware. So historically, like, languages that give you really great performance are actually really old languages. Like, C is still one of the most widely used languages in the world because it gets you such strong performance. C came out in 1972, and its whole big deal is that it's basically efficient. C's sort of claim to fame is being known as, quote, portable assembly language. In other words, it's about as low level as assembly language. It has a few conveniences, but it gives you like complete control over your hardware. So there's really basically no overhead between your C program and the hardware underneath it. C++ from 1985, also one of the most popular high-performance languages out there, still one of the most widely used languages today. And again, the main reason is because it's very efficient. One of C++'s goals was to introduce object-oriented programming to C so that you could have those constructs as a convenience for the programmer while still maintaining the same level of efficiency and performance as C. In other words, having no or as little as possible between you and what the hardware is capable of. And it's not until 2010 that we get something that really can be considered a serious challenger to the sort of the throne of C and C++ that have been at the top of the heap for so long, which is Rust. Rust, again, very, very efficient. Almost nothing between a compiled Rust program and what the hardware is capable of. But rather than going in the object-oriented direction like C++ did, because Rust is not an object-oriented language, Rust said, you know what? We just want to be reliable, efficient, and ergonomic. And that's kind of the whole goal of Rust. I know ergonomic is not one of the words that they use to describe themselves. They just focus on efficient and reliable. But I would say compared to both of these things, not only is Rust a lot more reliable, it's also a lot more ergonomic than C or C++. Okay, so here's a concrete example of this. Here's an error that you would get in from the Rust compiler if you had, let's say, a typo. It says no field email on type user, because I misspelled email. It says note available fields are name and email. Now, contrast this to the same error in C++, this is what you get. Main.cpp error, no member named email in user, and that's about it. Doesn't really show you the line number or, you know, hint at like what are some of the available fields. Maybe you have a typo there. So this is a pretty big improvement, and you can sort of extrapolate this to more complicated errors like type mismatches and things like that. It's just generally a much friendlier experience than you would get from something like C or C++, even modern C and C++ compilers. Now, granted, I'm not going to say that Rust is like the most ergonomic language that I've ever used or the nicest in terms of compiler errors. That would be Elm. So here's what it is when Rust, and then the same error in Elm would be something like this. The user record does not have an email field. This is usually a typo. Here are the user fields that are most similar. So maybe email should be email. If you've never used Elm before, I teach a course on it right here on Frontend Masters. And it's really the most delightful language I've ever used. But again, we're not trying to compare Rust, at least in my mind, to really high-level languages like Elm that are sort of designed around ergonomics and delightfulness. What we're comparing it to is languages that have that same level of efficiency like C and C++, because that's where Rust really shines, is when you want that level of performance. And when you're up at that tier of performance, like Rust is just leaps and leaps and bounds ahead of the competition as far as I'm concerned. So let's talk about numeric types. So here I've said let mut y equals 2.2. And then later on, I've said y equals 3.1. And then let's suppose right after that, I said y equals the string 3.1. So this would not work because in Rust, although you're allowed to reassign things, once you define a value, that value gets a particular type associated with it. And you're not allowed to change that at runtime. Even though you're allowed to reassign values of the same type, you can't change to a different type. So this would be an example of changing from a float to a string, and that's not allowed in Rust. Now, we didn't have any type annotations in that example, but if I wanted to, I could add a comment here. This is a comment in Rust, say, hey, by the way, X is a float. But really, I would never do that because what I would do instead is I would actually write a type annotation like this, saying X colon F64. F64 is short for 64-bit floating point number. So we'll talk about the different numeric types in a second. But basically, the reason that I might do this is I might want to be explicit about the type of X. Now, you notice that I didn't have to do this. So there's plenty of languages where you have to write out the types of absolutely everything. In Rust, at least when it comes to let, you don't have to do that. Rust will be able to do type inference and, generally speaking, be able to figure out that, okay, I see that you assigned X to 1.1. That's some sort of floating point number. Okay, no problem. You don't actually need to write out the F64. And in fact, if I want to, I could write it out for X, but not for Y. That's another thing I could totally do. But importantly, it doesn't always get that. It's not always able to provide that. So in some cases, Rust type inference, when you get into more complicated types, probably won't actually happen in the course of this workshop. But as you get into more advanced Rust, sometimes when you write let, Rust, the compiler will say, okay, I need you to write out the type annotation because I can't quite figure out what this is. But it's important to note that it'll never get it wrong. Like it'll never misinfer something and say like, oh yeah, I know what the type is. And then it actually is a different type. The worst that'll happen is either it'll get it right and say, great, I was able to infer that. Or it'll say, hey, I couldn't figure this out. I need you to tell me, I need you to write out the type annotation. So the compiler is at least reliable when it comes to that, even if it's not 100% able to always offer that. So let's look at defining our own functions. Let's say I wanted to say let answer equals and then call a function called multiply both, passing two floats, and then print the answer here. Here's how I would define that function. Say function multiply both, X is an F64, Y is an F64, and it returns an F64. So here, although main didn't have any arguments, multiply both is taking two arguments. Now, when you're defining functions, you do have to write out the type annotations always. That's a rule in Rust. So if I'm saying multiply both is a function that takes X and Y, I do have to say what their types are, and then I also have to say what the return type of the function is. And then I can use the return keyword to say return x times y. So you can sort of read this type annotation here as multiply both takes two F64 arguments and returns an F64. Whereas main takes no arguments and returns nothing. So if your function doesn't return anything, you don't have to put this arrow here. You can just leave it off. Okay. We did talk about the difference between macros and functions, but here we can actually see in the way that we're calling multiply both, we're not using the exclamation point here. So this is the first time that we've seen something without that exclamation point. But in normal Rust code, this is way more common, and the exclamation point is only used for the occasional macro, which definitely come up plenty often, but not nearly as often as normal function calls. Okay, any questions about the differences there and anything we've talked about in terms of type annotations and functions? So the question is basically, is there some way to sort of maybe trick the Rust compiler by saying this thing has the type object or maybe the type any, and then that would allow you to reassign it on the fly from a float to a string or vice versa? Is that the quest? Is that cool? Yeah, so the short answer is no, you can't do that. So Rust does not have an any type. It also doesn't have, like Java, you have object and like everything inherits from object just about. It doesn't have either of those. In fact, Rust doesn't have inheritance in general. So basically, there really is no way to get around that. Now, it is possible to have collections which contain multiple different types for their elements. Like you can have like an array that contains simultaneously a string for some of its elements and a float for other elements. But the way that you do that is using something called enums, which we'll get to in, I think, two sections from now. So we haven't gotten there yet. But in general, short answer is, yeah, you can't do that. So to recap, we have this city size thing, and a town is 1,000 residents, a city is 10,000, a metropolis is 1 million. So when we are duplicating this branch, I'm just going to copy paste this whole thing and just change those numbers around, basically. So we've got town, I'm going to do city, and also metropolis. City has a residence of 10,000, and metropolis was 1 million. And so here I'm just going to replace the word here. I'm going to say a city of approximately that many residents, and here a metropolis. Again, as with before, if we wanted to, we could do some more code sharing here, but since this is just an exercise, we're not going to bother with that. The main thing to note is that we now have three branches, and all three of them are basically the three different variants of this enum. We're not using any payloads in this example, but if we wanted to, we could very well introduce a payload here and just say like, hey, metropolis now has an I-64 inside of it. But we're not going to bother with that for this case. Okay, we're still getting this error here. And we're going to fix that by replacing this city struct with a call to city colon colon new. And it takes two arguments. One is a city size. So I'm going to pick metropolis. Why not? And notice like my autocomplete here now actually has the three possible variants here. So this is something that Rust Analyzer is aware of. It knows, oh, well, there's exactly three different possibilities that could be here. So I'm just pick metropolis. And then in the previous one, this time, I guess I will make it be coastal. Why not? So we've got a coastal metropolis, as many of them are, I suppose. Okay, and now I should be able to run this. And once again, we're gonna get some warnings. We'll come back to those in a second, but it says this city is a metropolis of approximately 1 million residents. Wow. Okay, now we did see is coastal is never read here. So that was a warning there for this thing, because in this example, we never actually read the is coastal field. You may recall in the previous example that we never read the residence field. Nothing to be concerned about, totally fine for things to be unused. But you might also notice that we see this warning. Variant is never constructed city. Variant is never constructed town. So actually the warning that we're getting here is it's saying, hey, you said that these two are possibilities, but in practice, you never actually use either of these two. And that's because I chose metropolis down here. Now, if I change this to city, now it's going to complain that town and metropolis are not used and city was used. So this is another interesting feature of enums, is that it's a way of expressing here are all the different possibilities, but Rust will say, hey, if some of these possibilities never come up in practice, maybe you might as well just get rid of them. Not something you have to deal with, and there are ways you can suppress those warnings if you want to. But worth noting that one of the nice things about enums is that the compiler is really keenly aware of these are all the possibilities that you have to deal with. There are no other possible values that we could have for city size other than the exact three that we've defined here.
I was curious if you could illustrate how we could build like a custom example, say it didn't fall in either of those three, and we just wanted to enter our own resident amount.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so I'll add another one. Okay, so I could say area with residence U64. I could do it either like this, so this would be the struct style, or if I wanted to, I could put it in parentheses like this. Now it's kind of interesting to see, if I do it in parentheses, then I can't label it. So I'm gonna use it struct style just because otherwise it's not really clear what that U64 is doing. So here it's a little bit clearer. That's like, okay, it's the residence count. So notice that when I do this, I'm now going to get an error here on match city size where it says missing match arm, non-exhaustive, I can't move my mouse to show you, but non-exhaustive patterns area ... not covered. Ensure that all possible cases are being handled, possibly by adding wildcards or more match arms. So basically what it's telling me is like, hey, you need to either do something like this where I make this be an underscore that will fix that problem. And it won't complain about that anymore. Or I need to add an explicit match arm for our new area thing. And I'll say residence. Okay. And now I guess I'm just going to not bother doing that. I'm just going to, we've already got the residence that was stored in there. And so now I'll just do that. That's how we do it. And everything else should work, although it's going to complain that area is never constructed. But I guess if we want to see that in action, I could just say city size, area, and then I'd say residence. I don't know. This is a really small area. 5 people in this one. Okay. And yeah, sure enough, it runs. This city is I said metropolis in there. How about an area? There we go. Rerun that. So yeah, this city is an area of approximately 5 residents. So there you go.